I didn't speak much about Kalpana Swara, but I think we kind of flowed into most of Manodharma's aspects quite nicely in conversation, which was nice instead of it being a lecture, so to speak. So Kalpana Swara is what is considered, many people find very exciting about Carnatic music, especially the faster Kalpana Swara. I think it's a bit overstated, but that's my personal opinion. It's probably the easiest thing to do. If you're a Carnatic musician, I can tell you, Manodharma is taught, the first thing that is taught is Kalpana Swara singing. Correct, Dana? Because it's kind of the little easiest thing to give. The toughest thing to sing is Nerval. The hardest thing to sing in Nerval, along with it, is Tanam. These two make it very, very difficult. So it's usually Kalpana Swara, then a bit of Alapana, and then you come to Nerval. Many times in the Carnatic form, what happens, unfortunately, which is also true, is that when the presentation is made, the Nerval is usually not expanded as much as it can be. It's usually given kind of stepmotherly treatment many times. So you'll find a long Alapana, you'll find a composition which is big, you'll find Nerval being not explored enough, and Kalpana Swara, of course. So that sometimes is unfortunate, because Nerval is probably the most magical part of using a composition line in syllabic form, which I think needs to be, we need to do more of that. There's no doubt about that. So, now, most people think that the most interesting part of the, or difficult part of the Kalpana Swara is coming to the symbolic sum, or the abstract sum, if you want to call it the abstract sum, not as physically, but the idea of the sum, the point of origin, like we sang. But actually, that is the easiest thing to do. It's not as difficult. Even students, I can tell you, I have two of them sitting behind me, that there's a panic that will set in when you, that approach to that point of composition comes, there'll be like palpitations among all students, like, am I going to go there? Am I going to land up there? You know? So especially, even in simple, like, take a simple thing. Kapali. This is as basic as you can get for a place for a Kalpana Swara. I mean, can't get more basic than this. This is on the beat of the beginning of the tala. So, what usually happens is, pagare sarika. Now, how does, there's one unsaid thing I spoke about in the last time also, that this idea of five as the end, or three as an end, is an unsaid point of entry. So, you just watch them, he will accent that when we come there. So that's the that's what actually gives the audience a feeling that you're coming to the point. The place could be anywhere. It need not be on the sum. But that will give the audience a feeling that it's coming. When you see that there is discord between two, you can be sure it's muffed by one of the two parties. Something has gone wrong at that point of time. We know that something is gone. So, but actually this is not such a difficult thing to do. So when we teach, what we try and do is we tell them to keep certain constants. For example, say keep pagari sari. Just keep pagari sari. Let that be there. Keep singing and just come to pagari sari. Let the ending be constant. But the toughest part is two things. One is to get a flow of singing, articulating swaras in flow. Now also in our form, we have to be very rigid to the laya. We can't ga da ga pa ri. That is not permitted in this form. So ga pa pa ga ri ga 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 ri sa ri ga sa ri ga pa ri ga pa da ga. So even if I sing a gamaka like sangatis, it has to be with the ga pa da ga pa da sa pa da ga pa ga ri ga. So it has to have that rigidity with the laya. So what becomes difficult for a student usually is ga pa ri ga ri pa ri ga pa sa ri sa ga da ri sa pa sa ga da ga ri sa ri ga ri da ga pa da sa pa ga ri da ri ga da ga ri ga pa li. Another unsaid thing, all these are unsaid, is that the last note, swara, which is rendered before you start the line you've chosen. By the way, we can choose any line, any point in a composition to sing swara. It doesn't have to be the palvi, it doesn't have to be the first line, it doesn't have to be any line. I can choose anything. Kapali, I can choose any part of the composition, even a complicated place. It's just our choice. Sometimes when you're singing, you bump into place. For example, there's another Kirtram in Saberi. Durusuga krepa jochi santa tamaro de deda shari ramuna chalupuna chalupuna ro. Now the charanam. Sarojanayana nadajana pa. Ippudu is the magic of this composition. Duru suga sarojanayana nadajana pali ni pali edamulu morali daga mudelu ramana vivini krepa chalu para kusalu para dikani yudulu nida sada. Unusual take. It starts. Now I can choose this if I choose. I think this is a very unusual phrase in this ragam in the context. Garini. Garini in Saveri, like that is just magic. I mean, Shama Shastri has to be given all the credit for that. It's almost standalone. So now suppose I'm inspired at that point. So I can sing Swara there. There's no rule. So the placement becomes somewhere in between. Which means, again, the challenge for the violinist is massive. To immediately have the reflex to be able to sing the ragam, and you know, in the context. Now the unwritten rule is to have a swara that is before the swara of the first syllable of the chosen word. But actually, the most amazing thing about singing Kalpana Swara is not to get stuck with it. To be able to end in any swara and then loop it back to that swara. Nida ni pada pa ye budu du ni namaga gare sa ye budu dasari pa ma ye budu dari ni dasa ye budu dasari ge budu ri ni da ye budu dari ni da ye budu dani pada ye budu sama pada ye budu. That's the whole beautiful part. If you can connect, then you can connect from anywhere. Anywhere. It doesn't have to matter where you are. Which means you need to know the raga well enough inside you to not be lost. Pama, 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 pari, pama, pada, pama, pama, agari, sari, ma, pama, ibudu. You can change E also. No harm done. You can do anything. You can go. So that is the Kalpana Swara comes alive. My guru Shamugari Srinivasayar used to sing the most amazing first speed Kalpana Swara. Incredible. I mean, it was just stunning. And he will bring connections quite magically. Yes, I mean, people always talk about his second speed Kalpana Swaras, which were like major supersonic flights. But actually, his first speed Kalpana Swaras were really something else. Because very important, the first speed is in this laya fixed. The raga, gamaka, and the curves have to be completely there. Ma ba da ba ma ba da ma da di da ma ba da di da ma ba da di ba ba da ba ma ba da ni ma ba da ni ma ba da ni ba ni da ni ma ba da sa ba da sa ri ba ba ni ma ba da sa da ni ma sa ri ma This is the tough thing. So if you listen to more Carnatic music, I would rather you go into this than bother about coming to landing point. Because this is where you know whether the real Kalpana Swara is being sung or not. You can do a lot of fraud by singing, having absolutely no swara flow, but just having this ending being a big bang ending. Seems like it's all worked. No, it's not worked at all. So which is why the landing point is actually secondary to the flow of the swara for me. Sometimes it's even okay if the point goes awry. But the flow that is taken there is so brilliant, you just don't care. Big deal. Okay, it missed by two matras. Okay, big deal. We'll come back next time. You know, it doesn't make a big difference. So I think this, when we listen to Kalpana Swara, we should need kind of change our head gear a bit and say, okay, what's happening in the raga? It all has to be in the raga. If it's not in the raga, it's a waste of everybody's time. Has to be there. Ma rubal ka onna me mi ba ma Yeah. Sing it stunningly. Kirtanam like this, then it makes sense to sing swaram like this. Now, because of the feeling that this, of course, generates excitement, there's no argument there. The tendency to do this for everything is also there, which is problematic. Now, my aesthetic choice, by the way, it's years since I ever sang this composition like this. That's why these guys were laughing, by the way. If you knew, want to know why they were laughing because they have not heard me sing like this for the last 10 years at least. But that's an aesthetic choice. That's a choice of aesthetics, that choice of approach. But if you're going to sing Marubalkar in this form, then it demands this of you. I can sing the same Marubalkar. Now Darini ke chains.
Darina devi santa silli na. Darina devi santa silli na. Silli na. Santa Silina Tigarinarigi.
Now, this is the same sheet engineering, the same composition. But then the texture has to change. Now, if I sang fast speed swaram when I'm singing like this, it's utterly ridiculous. Is what should be sung for this.
The ni sa da ni sa ri ni sa ri ga ri da ni na ri.
So, Kalpana Swara has its place and has a very important place, but it also has many more shades to it than what we generally imbibe from it. And the shade should primarily be the raga shape. And there are certain ragas, I mean, this is, again, these are all, there's subjective points, there are questions of even some things that I'm still debating sometimes. Some ragas I just feel just don't work for second speed Kalpana Swara. But again, we are tempted to do it. The temptation is there. Some ragas are not there because their aesthetic framework does not give Madhyamakala opening at all. We can force it in. An intelligent musician can, of course, force it in. But do we need to do that? Does it mean that the raga is limited? No, it does not mean. Manji, for example, is a classic in which I think anybody sings second speed Kalpana Swara, they should stop singing. I'm sorry, I'm sounding, but if somebody sings second speed Kalpana Swara Manji, for example, any of the composition, Ramachandra Samrayakshito Sita. Heart of this is the heart of that raga. So there are these questions that are there. What are the ragas where? So laya of the raga. What is the bandwidth of the laya of the raga? What bandwidth can you explore? How much can you extend it? Which ragas allow you for that? Some ragas will not allow you for slow speed, for example. You cannot sing them like in this kind of an expanse. You have to sing them in a certain Madhyamakala rigor, or slightly even push rigor. There are those ragas too. So these kind of interesting questions also erupt. The laya of whatever we sing, is we have to think about it. So Melkala and Neraval sometimes again, is the appropriateness is something every musician has to think about. I'm not going to pass judgment, but if you ask me whether I would sing Melkal Nerval when I sang the Leisurely Marubalkam, my answer will be no.
Sir, you had sung it, there's a record.
Then it's probably wrong. Maybe I should not have sung. That's also possible, right? I can make mistakes too. So I'm allowed to do that too. And you're allowed to tell me that I made a mistake. So it's possible. I mean, also depends context. I have to listen to it. I can listen to tell you it is awful or not.
Sir, one thing was that in that record, you both were playing. Even the Melkal Nerval was kind of, it was not like forced.
So I sang pretty decently, what you're saying. Thank you. Thank you very much for the compliment. Okay, then in which case I think you could have sung it. I agree. Completely agree with you. That's sweet. Thanks. I just want to take it at 15 minutes. I need 10 minutes. Because I've not spoken about Thani Avarthanam. I just have to speak about it because we don't speak about it. We speak about it in all the wrong ways. Most people associate, general public associate Carnatic music with rhythm. It's also a mindset. Generally, if you think of Carnatic music, you think of heavy rhythm there. It's like they're bombarding us. And I won't tell you that I spoke about it last time. One of the reasons for that imagery is also because the tightness of the laya that is there in the way we sing. We have to sing that way. It's the form. So the Thani Avarthanam is a very interesting form. Now, I have both last time and this time, more or less, I have limited my conversations to what is usually seen in the concert, and I'm not placing what I usually do or I like to reinterpret and rediscover, because that is a personal thing and that is not something we should be discussing. We're discussing in general forms. So Thani Avarthanam in general is usually, there's this idea of one composition being the central composition. Like she rightly pointed out, one of the things about Carnatic music also, there are many compositions. That's again something that Carnatic musicians need to seriously debate about. Whether we need so many compositions in a concert, why do we need so many compositions, all these things. And this has got nothing to do with the length of the alapana, but just the idea of what do these compositions do. If I sing anything, anywhere, it must have an aesthetic intention and reason to be there. It can't be there because the formulae works. That's the basic premise of the discussion. Now, Thani Avarthanam, if there's a mridangam and a ghatam, it is general that the ghatam or the ganjira follows the mridangam. A usual Thani Avarthanam, if I give Adi Tala, just to make things simple, in Chatushra, if I'll say Rendukala because it gives some opening to them. So if this is the Kala Pramanam, there are two things. One is the laya of the line, and usually, if I've sung Nerval, now for example, if I sang Marubalka in the leisurely pace and I sang only slow speed Nerval and slow speed Swaram, that texture of tone is what I will talk. The texture of tone must be reflected in the Thani Avarthanam. That would be ideal. Is the texture of tone. And here we also forget that the tonality, the sound level, or the level of the power of the sound of the mridangam or the ghatam has to be close to what is being done by the melodic people. So if I sang now this is it. I've left this place for Thani Avarthanam. Let him play a bit. Thank you. this tonality is very important when I've sung Marubalka like this. And what they do in the first round, as we call it the first round, is they play in Chatushra, because this is in four. So they'll start playing different frameworks. Again, it's not the total, it's also in between. They keep playing in between, in between, in between. They can sometimes build on one phrase, and that phrase can be built on, built on, built on. Sometimes can be a math composite, just a mathematical idea, which can be rebuilt on, built on. And finally, they end with what is a korvai. Again, the essence of the korvai is breaking down the tala into different segments, into the total math. In Adi Tala, how many matras are there? How can I break it into two parts, each having three parts, traditionally? So there's a lot of math involved. And usually they played thrice. So every round ends with a korvai. You could have korvais in between also, but every round will end with the korvai. That is the completion. Now when he finishes like this, the idea is that the ghatam picks off there. The ghatam need not play exactly what he played. Not at all necessary. But the tone and texture is carried forward. Malaya. So he took a small phrase and then built a chorus from this. He played just with the rhythm itself and took a chorus from this. Now usually the second round, they change the chatushra. They could play tishra, they could play kanda, they could play mishra, they could play sankirna, any of them. That is either 3, 5, 7 or 9, which means between, for those who are not technically oriented, every beat, the pause between every beat can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 9 is not possible. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 9, whatever it is. Okay. 9. It depends on that. So that, the only thing is when they play one of those nadais of the five jatis, they have to maintain that right through. You can't play, you can't generally mix, say, two nades in between one form. Basically, in principle, what we allow for is one laya, one jati layering over the fundamental. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, you can layer 3, you can layer 5. You can't layer 3 and 5. That we can't do. So there is that little thing. So second round usually is a nade. Fives. Now this seems very simple. This is not very simple. What he actually did was ta ka ta ki ta 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 ka ta ki ta ta ka ta ki ta 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 Now, he's maintaining fives in one beat. So this is khandam he played. So again, the beautiful thing about it is to do it also with that tonality and do it with the same equanimous sense. You can make this all a riot act. You know, need not be a riot act. It can be a riot act when it needs to be. But in this case, it need not be. So after they play khandam, they usually play again a khanda korva in khanda. Usually second round is like this, and the third round what they do is known as a korep. So again, it's a measure. All these are measures. So they take from the actual sum of the talam. They can do korepas based on fives, based on sevens. So basically, where will I start the first five? I put a question to all of you actually. So this is Aditala. Taka dimi taka janut. Dimi taka janut. Taka dimi taka janut. Okay. Now I want you to start fives, that is taka taketa taka taka, in the same chatushra. Where will I have to begin it for the last taka taketa to come on the sum? What? So basically I'm saying I must have taka taketa 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 taka taketa. What's the total count? Anybody? I'll go again. Taka taketa 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 taka. How many? What's total? 5 into 8? 5 into 8? Was it 8?
Not
8. How much was it? How much was it? Not 40. So I'm asking him. I asked, what did I say now? What is the total of what I said now? Takata kita, 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 ta. What's the total of what I said? It's very simple. 2 rounds of Aditala is how much? 2 rounds.
60.
Huh? So 60, right? So keep 60. What is half of 60? Now watch. Taka takita taka takita taka takita taka takita taka takita taka takita ta. Okay? What is half of 30? 15. Taka takita taka takita taka takita taka takita taka 15. So the math is 60, 30, 15. Now their job is to play around with the 60, play around with the 30, and play around with the 15. So he's going to do a kanda korupu now, which will start here in the first little finger. Taka takita 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 taka takita. Doing is they're taking the 60 and creating math in between. Then they will bring 30. Is mathematical. The reduction is not arbitrary. This same math can be done with 7. But by the way they play with that 60 can be extremely complex. They just showed you the simplest possibility. But that 60 can be complicated in so many different forms. The 30 can be. The nice thing is when the idea of the 60 is also truncated to the idea of the 30. That is, the complexity of the 60 can be that itself can be reduced to 30. That itself is reduced to 15. You can do that with 7. You can do that with 9. At the end, they come together. And they play together. And finally, they play what is known as a mohra and a kora. Mohra is obviously not a Tamil word. Right? So it comes from the Tanjavur area, where there's a great influence of the Marathas there, the Islamic traditions. So the mohra probably came from also somewhere the Dholki tradition, which was there in that region. The mohra is as a very interesting form. I'm not going to discuss it here. But that is what is an indicator for everybody that the Thani Avarthanam is going to come to an end. So they used to call it Mohra Tadhinatom. Tadhinatom, like I told you, is the catch, right? It's ending, 5. But what they do is they play a Mohra and they play another Korve, usually a slightly bigger one, 3 times. All Korves are played 3 times in general. That's a kind of a thumb rule. So the Mohra for Aditalam, again, there are amazing ones. I'll ask him to play just same the Vashtu on the the usually the form of Thani Avarthanam. We gave you the simplest way it can be done. A lot can be built on this mathematically in terms of forms, in terms of ideas. But this is what a Thani Avarthanam is. It's there's a lot happening in between it, in it, which is layered. And I just thought it's important that you understand the dynamics of the Thani Avarthanam also, because it just sounds like a lot of rhythm happening. But there is a build up, there is a structuring, there is the formulae, there is all that within it. And it kind of extends to the interpretation of how the mridangam looks at the tala. I think we'll end with this. We're way, way out of beyond time.